Club Studio Paint just came out with a new version, which is version 3.0. This version comes with a bunch of new features, and most of these are a direct response from users submitting requests. Thanks so much to Club Studio Paint for letting me try out this version a little early so I can show you all the cool new features. Now let's take a look at what's in this version. First up, we got new filters. This version has a bunch of cool new filters to add to your art. When you apply these filters, it only appears on what's on the layer, but for this video, I'm just gonna show it on a single image layer right here so you can see what it looks like. So just go to Filter and Effect. This is where all the new filters are. First up, we got Pencil Drawing. This one gives a cool pencil-like filter. You can see the pencil strokes, and it gives off a really nice texture. There's some settings for you to adjust. You can either show outline and show hatching, or one or the other. This is what it looks like with no outline, which is really cute. Or you can show outline and take out the hatching, which just converts this into a pencil-like drawing. We got hatching size, hatching roughness. This makes it more intense. And hatching angle. This just rotates it around. Next up, we got Chromatic Aberration. This one is really cool. You can see it gives off this 3D-like effect. Without a filter, creating this effect yourself is a little bit difficult. You would have to use several layers and then position each of the colors yourself. But this one, you just use everything with one button. There's a radial and a lateral. So with radial, you get to choose where the center point of the 3D effect takes place. So I'll have it at her face, and I can change the intensity. Just this much looks good enough to put on your art, or you can just make this go super trippy. And lateral will affect the entire layer, so the center point doesn't really affect it. You would have to adjust the angle right here, and it will just rotate around. Next up is noise, which you already have this in render, Perlin noise, but this just slaps noise onto the entire layer. But if you go into effect, noise, this one is an actual filter. You can see my artwork is still there. I can choose between color, which makes all the dots colorful, or I can choose gray, which is obviously black and white. I'm so glad that there's a color option because I've always wanted to use color noise, but Clip Studio didn't have that before, but now I can use it. I'm so happy. And next up, we got retro film. This is like a film camera. You can choose from a preset right here. They have three of them: vintage, modern, warm, or none, which is like if I select the first one and start to adjust it, this would turn to none because it means I'm not using the preset but using my own adjustments. So let's take a look. This is vintage. It has like the noise and chromatic aberration mixed in together, and there's sepia coloring to it as well. Next up is modern, which is similar but without the colorings, and warm. This one doesn't have the noise filter or chromatic aberration, just a really nice sepia color to it. Or I can just choose from here. I'll choose light leak. This one's really nice, and increase the chromatic effect and a little bit more noise. So this is something that you can play with. It's really, really cool. If you want to add like final touches to your art, I think it's really nice. So see my art before and then after. It looks so much cooler. And finally, we have normal maps. So Clip Studio Paint allows 3D models with normal maps to be loaded. And now they've implemented a normal map generate filter to deepen the compatibility feature. So anything on the current layer can turn into a normal map. And this filter is used as textures for 3D models. So in using 3D, you would need a normal map, the regular texture and other files and stuff. You can adjust the strength, the intensity of it, and the Y orientation. This Y down and Clip Studio 3D standard format. You hit OK, export this, and then use it in whatever 3D program that you use. Speaking of 3D textures, Clip Studio Paint can now preserve transparent information when you're exporting PSD or PSB files, which is Photoshop file. This means when you're making a 3D texture and some parts are transparent, this will actually keep this transparent when you import it into Blender or Unity instead of just being flat solid. In previous versions, any of you folks using 3D would have to export from Clip Studio Paint, then import into another application, export that before putting it into your 3D program. But now you don't. With this update, transparent information is now reserved. Okay, so let me show you a file that I have made in the old Clip Studio Paint version. As you can see, if I open it up, it has a transparent background. You can see the checkerboard in the back. There's nothing behind this. There's only one layer, so that means it's transparent. I have saved it as a Photoshop file, so if I import this to anywhere, it should only show the heart and nothing else. So I'm going to go import this into Blender and use it as a texture and try to make it transparent, but as you can see, it stays white and there's no way for me to use this. Now I'm going to make another file, but in Clip Studio Paint version 3.0. So I'll delete the paper layer, so now it's transparent, and let's draw something on it. Okay, cute. Now I'll save it as Photoshop document, name this new, save it to my desktop. Now I'm gonna do the exact same steps that I did with the previous file, but as you can see, This one actually has transparency. You can see through the heart. I can actually use it for 3Ds. So 3D artists, you can all rejoice. Back to more color stuff. There's a new color match feature. This is like using gradient map, but instead of picking the colors yourself, you can just use color match to grab the colors from an image. So go to edit, tonal correction, and it's right down here, color match. So version 3.0 comes with like preset images. You can just click on an image and it'll just grab the colors from the photo. Maintain brightness will maintain like the contrast of your image. But if you take it out, this will pretty much convert all colors to the colors on the image. Like, this is a really neat effect. This is really nice. You've got grayscale, this color. This one's really interesting. And you can actually bring up your own images as well. Like, let me try it with this photo right here. This is pretty neat. You can adjust the intensity as well. Maybe if I want just a little bit more color change to it. Or if it's easier for you, just grab a color palette image like this. You can just grab one from anywhere on the internet. And as you can see, it applied all the colors here. So how it works, just like gradient map, is dark colors will go on dark parts of your image. Light colors will go on places that are light, like her shirt. Originally, it is like this very dark blue. Her skin is the lightest color. Medium, which would be her hair. So for this color palette, the dark blues went to her shirt, this eggshell color went to her skin, and anything else in between, like the yellow, red, and green, applied to all the gray areas, if you want to know how that works. I think this would be really good for the sketching stage when you're trying to figure out all the overall color composition. You're trying to do like complementary colors or any other color schemes, and this would quickly apply the colors to your art. You could just start out with a grayscale and then apply color match to it. Import export support of WebP. Have you ever saved an image from a website and you're a little annoyed that it's not PNG but it's WebP instead? Well, now you too can annoy other people trying to save your art and trying to use it in other programs. I'm joking. Okay, so WebP is a file format that's now replacing old formats like JPG and PNG and even GIFs. The file's a lot smaller, but still high quality. So as you can see, in the previous versions, you'd get an error. You wouldn't be able to drag and drop it into Clip Studio Paint. But now in this version, you can now import and export the WebP format. So you can actually import it. I can also save it as a WebP format. That's how I save this image right here. And this is pretty good if you have a website and you need images to look clear and crisp, but also load pretty fast. My own website is suffering this issue. Maybe I need to re-export using this version. Next up, we have Postmaniacs Association. If you've never heard of them, Postmaniacs is an amazing website for drawing references, mostly known for their like muscly models to reference for poses and anatomy. I really recommend this site for everyone. They have a lot of other tools for you to use as well. And now in this version, if you view a pose and you really like it and you want to use it in Clip Studio Paint, you can actually do that now. So all you got to do is have a canvas open, go to File, Import, and then 3D Pose Postmaniacs. This will automatically bring up the website so you don't have to type in the URL yourself. You can filter by gender and by tag. Let's say I'll just go with this one right here. And on the website, you can actually rotate, do some other settings down here for the pose. But if you look down here, there's a Clip Studio Paint launch button. Just hit that, hit launch, and this will automatically pop up Clip Studio Paint. You can choose a model. You have the male, female, and then the drawing figures. And if you have like your own downloaded body shapes, you can use that as well. But for this, I'll just go with the female. And here is the pose. I can use this as drawing reference, and I can also use all the other settings that Clip Studio Paint has. This is fully adjustable. I can change the gender right here as well if I want to. I can also flip the pose around. So I can freely repose this and edit it to my liking. This version comes with a couple of new text options. First up is circular text, which, as the name says, turn text into a circle. So you can enable it by going to the subtool detail, circular text, and show all of these so you can enable these options. It's down here, so make sure you select your text. Tick on circular text, and all your text is in a circle. You can change the radius, or just by transforming it right here. There's options to change the direction, like this is clockwise, this is counterclockwise, which puts it inside the circle. You can make it space evenly, so it just closes up that gap right there. Okay, so this is neat and all that, but you don't actually just have to use it like just regular text, slap it onto a background or use it as a logo or something, or like maybe a book cover. You can be pretty creative with this. So I went and downloaded a runic-like font. Let me just type in random stuff. And then, even though this is text, I can actually use this for something like maybe an arcane circle and use it in like sort of magical sort of art. I can rasterize so it's no longer a text. Now it's just an image layer, and then I can just transform this and play around with it. Or you can try this out with dingbat type of fonts and use this as like a pattern for like clothing or in the background. You can really have fun with this. So, you know, sort of something like this. The next text tool we have is Text Tool Property Contextual Alternates. So if you can see these two fonts right here, the top one is called a serif font. The bottom one is called a sans serif font. Sans serifs don't have these little tapers right here. So now Clip Studio added contextual alternates, and I'll show you what this does. Let me highlight this and go to Subtool Detail, go to Font, and you can see down here there's this little O icon. It says contextual alternates, turn that on. And as you can see before and after, you can see the I on the sans serif font turned into a serif font. So this I right here. This is something pretty common in Western comics where you should differentiate between the I's that are in the same sentence. Like this standalone I is different from the one inside Clip and Studio. But now you can have this option enabled when you're making comics. Also, you see this font down here? Clip Studio Paint made it. It's called Clip Studio Comic, and it's automatically added to your fonts library in version 3.0. It's a very nice comic font that actually alternates between glyphs to like give it a more handwritten feel. So make sure you have contextual alternates on right here. And if I repeat a single letter, let's zoom in, you can see that each letter has a slight difference between them. Like for the first letter, the cross goes out a little bit. For the first one, it starts right here instead. You can see this curves up, this one curves down. This affects all of the letters, so each letter has like several glyphs. There's a very slight difference, but it's a really nice, simple detail. Next up is layer comps. This has been highly requested to implement a feature that's kind of like Photoshop's layer comps. I'll show you what it does. Just go to Window and Layer Comps to turn it on right here. What Layer Comps does is basically save the visibilities of certain layers. So for example, I have this piece of art right here and I can't choose between several versions. Like maybe I should go with these glasses, this color instead. I also have the layers separated for the frame and the color. Same goes for the earrings. Maybe I want to try her out with this hair color instead. So instead of having two whole folders of all these layers, I can just go back to my default. This is the color that I went with. Hit this button right here, add layer comp, and this is now my new layer comp. Now let me show the layers for the other colors. Maybe I'll add a different colored background as well, maybe another decoration, and I'll add another layer comp. Now I can just quickly switch between these two versions to get a feel of which one I like more. Side note though, layer comps is only available on Clip Studio Paint X, not Pro, because on X you have options to make comics, and I guess this would be a very useful tool to switch between your sketch layer, colors, lines, because there's so many panels and stuff. This would just make your life a little bit more easier. All right, this next feature is for animators. You can now scrub the audio on the timeline. So this is what scrubbing is. It's just basically moving along the timeline. In previous versions, if you had an audio file up and you were scrubbing, you wouldn't be able to actually hear anything. If you want to hear something, you had to hit play. And this was really difficult for animators because they would have to lip sync, which is drawing the mouth to match the audio. They would have to do workarounds like making notes on the side and then hitting play. This just made the process super difficult. But now you can scrub the audio on the timeline. Here, I will import the audio that I used for this animation. Just go to Import, Audio, and I will scrub on the timeline. Hello. You can actually hear the audio. Hello. So animators' lives just got a little bit more easier. The next feature is Quick Access Palette. So Clip Studio Paint has a window called Quick Access. You can just go to Window and Quick Access right here. This is for you to register your favorite tools. You can register tools commands, auto actions, brushes, pretty much anything that you want. Just go to Quick Access and then just put anything you want in there. This is so it's easier to access your favorite tools instead of having to navigate through the app itself. Like I added this watercolor brush, the spray brush. You can have another set for like another set of tools if you like. And the new feature for this is that there is now a search box. Because sometimes you want to use something that you know is in the app but you just can't find it. Pretty much like me and my 500 brushes that I've downloaded, I get lost so often. Now let's say I'm looking for a flower brush that I downloaded. I remember the name though, so I can just go to the search box, type in its name, it's called Tulip. And here it is, right here. Clicking that takes me straight to that brush right there, and then I can just start using it immediately. I can also save it if I want to use it. Just right click or tap and hold for iPad and add to quick access. I'll add it to 2. And here it is right here. The final feature is keyboard shortcut support on simple mode. So on tablets, Clip Studio Paint has a simple mode. If you didn't know, just go to the Clip Studio Paint icon and switch to simple mode. As you can see, this changed to a simple and clean layout. So in previous versions, this simple mode didn't support any keyboard shortcuts, except for a few commands like undo or redo. But now in this version, you can use a bunch of more keyboard shortcuts, so you can make your workflow a lot more smoother. As of now, the shortcuts aren't customizable though, but you can check out the preferences to see what command uses what shortcut by going to the three dots up here, and then preferences and help. Down here is keyboard shortcuts, and this will list all of the shortcuts that you're able to use in simple mode. And those are the new features that are in Clip Studio Paint version 3.0. What do you guys think of these new features? Which one are you most excited for? Let me know in the comments. I'm definitely going to be using chromatic aberration pretty often. If you'd like to review the version yourself, head over to the link in the description for more information. Thanks for watching!